not so important. What you got here, that's worth living for.
True love. You heard him? You could not ask for a more noble cause than that.
Sonny, true love is the greatest thing in the world. Except for a nice MLT, mutton, lettuce, and tomato sandwich when the mutton is nice and lean and the tomato is ripe. They're so perky. I love that. But that's not what he said. He distinctly said to blave. And as we all know, to blave means to bluff. Huh? So you're probably playing cards and he cheated.
Witch.
I'm not a witch, I'm your wife. But after what you just said, I'm not even sure I want to be that anymore.
You never had it so good.
True love. He said true love, Matt.
Don't say another word, Valerie.
He's afraid. Ever since Prince Humperdinck fired him, his confidence is shattered.
Why'd you say that name? You promised me that you would never say that name.
What? Humperdinck? Humperdinck!
Stiegen!
Humperdinck! Humperdinck!
I'm not listening!
Somebody needs to go to church. Get back, witch. Okay. If you need a copy of the outline, raise your hand, no matter where you happen to be right now. Victorville, welcome. How you guys doing? Okay. That's what I thought. And Apple Valley and Phelan, we're blessed to have you join us as well. Today, as we continue our journey together at family camp, if you remember a few weeks ago, maybe a few months ago now, we published a schedule for you regarding the themes that we're dealing with in this particular series. And the idea of publishing this was not just to inform you, but to give you a heads up as to who you might want to invite to some of these presentations, because some of these themes I think might be pertinent to different individuals in your relational world, different families that are represented by your 8 to 15. Next weekend, for example, I'll be speaking on the subject of maximizing discipline in your home. And so there are some things that we have learned over the years that might be helpful to those who hear. And so we hope you'll come back and maybe bring someone that you know that might benefit from that particular concept, that idea. And so just keep this in mind, keep tracking on this, and you'll see some more as we still have a few more months in this series. But today what we want to do is to offend you. This is not our goal most weekends. I just want you to know that it probably will happen today. Not all of you, because I never offend everybody at once, but the offense ratio might be a little higher today. We oftentimes get notes that say, Pastor Tom, I want to take exception to something that you said this past weekend. And whenever I hear that, I always say, well, you might want to get into that long line that's forming over there, because we have a lot of opportunities week in and week out. We really understand our role is to teach the Bible, first and foremost, but also to be provocative, to provoke you into thinking differently. And maybe consider things that you may not have considered before. You don't have to agree with everything that I say, but you do have to consider the scriptures. And that's all we are trying to ask you, encourage you to do. The Bible describes itself as a mirror. And sometimes when you look into a mirror, you don't like what you see. Like this morning when you were getting ready to come to church. As you looked in the mirror, if you're like me, I'm looking in the mirror going, oh, my hairline is receding. But I'm getting a little more used to that now, but this is my point. Sometimes when you look in the mirror, you don't like what you see, but what you see is what you get. What you see is still reality. And so as we present some of these things to you today, if you take offense, it still is, in my humble opinion, what we need to consider as a church family. So before we go any further, would you please raise your right hand and repeat after me. I promise. Pastor Tom, to forgive you. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, good. That's kind of a creed that we take, an oath that we take, also a little prayer that we pray before we begin. Okay, we want to begin by looking at what Jesus said about himself, how he described himself. In fact, there's only one passage in the New Testament where Jesus says, this is what I am like in terms of my character. Not in terms of his mission, in terms of his messianic office, or what he came to accomplish in the world, but this is how he described himself. In verse 29, Matthew 11, take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Now, we're talking about conflict today. Minimizing conflict. And by the way, I should have said from the very beginning, rather than waste anybody's time, if none of you have any conflict in your family, you may leave right now. Okay, for the rest of you, if we were to learn this, we would not need to speak so often on the subject. Because we would incorporate this Christ-likeness into our attitudes at home. We all want to be like Jesus, right? I mean, everybody that wants to be like Jesus, say amen. Amen. All right. Well, the problem is, he says that he was gentle and humble. The way you speak and what you say. The way you live and how you live it out. If we were to speak humble things in a gentle way, how many times do we have conflicts with people in our families? Well, if we did that all the time, people like me would have to go out and get a different job because we'd be sitting around wondering what to do. Our job is to help people understand how they can better deal with the conflict in their lives. And there are five basic ways that people deal with conflict. And I want to begin with this because a couple of things. You will see yourself default to one of these five. Not all the time, but it will be a natural tendency for you, and we're all different, so you might look at this list and say, well, yeah, that's me more often than not, and somebody else in your home might actually apply a different technique in terms of dealing with conflict. The first is to withdraw. Some people just walk away from conflict. They think the best resolution, at least in the short term, is to not deal with it. Whether they walk away or they drive away, what they're saying is, it's just not worth it. I don't want the hassle. I can't process all of the conflict. Now, the problem with this as a standardized approach with conflict is that when we return, which we invariably have to do, the issue that caused the conflict is still there, still on the table, and now we have to decide what we want to do next. But dealing with conflict in this way sometimes actually can be the appropriate thing to do because conflict has reached a level where attitudes are so bad and the angst in the room is so high that it's better that you walk away, at least for the short term. But again, generally speaking, this is not a healthy way to deal with conflict all the time. A man and his wife had been married for over 50 years. Someone asked the man the secret of their marital bliss. Well, the man said, the wife and I had this agreement when we first got married. Went like this. When she was bothered by something, she'd just tell me and get it off her chest. And when I was mad at her about something, I was to take a long walk. I suppose you could attribute our happy marriage to the fact that I have largely led an outdoor life. You know, sometimes take a walk. The rest of the time, you might want to deal with it in another way. A second approach is to win. The only acceptable outcome of a conflict for people who tend to want to win is to win, because anything less than total victory is a diminishment of their esteem. Now, again, this doesn't sound like a very spiritual thing to do all the time. Gotta win, gotta win, gotta win. But when it comes to the battle of the wills with your children, there are times that you just have to win that. So again, this could be an appropriate way to deal with some conflict. And then there's to yield. Now, some people just give in and they submit. Sometimes it's a biblical thing to submit because you're having a conflict with someone who has spiritual authority or authority over you. But then there are not so good reasons to always yield. For example, you might be living in the same context with somebody who's category two. They always want to win, and so you think it's better just to yield because it's just too hard to do anything else. Some people actually have a personality trait of martyrdom, and it elevates their spiritual standing in the community because martyrdom is somehow considered to be a spiritual quality. Well, again, it might be appropriate most of the time. It probably is not. And then there's the compromise approach. This is the give a little, get a little approach, the approach that allows both parties to save face, but no one actually wins, and everybody comes out to some degree a loser. And people on both sides of the issue tend to walk away with a very low level of satisfaction, which brings us to the idea of actually resolving a conflict. It's the only approach where both parties come out winners because the issue is resolved and everybody's able to see, okay, this is what God wants us to do. Simple math dictates that we have to put issues behind us. Because number one, we have limited emotional capacity. We just can't continue to allow things to pile up emotionally. And the second reason is because things are going to still be coming down the pike. Families are typically backlogged when it comes to issues that need to be resolved. And so they're overwhelmed with this pile of unresolved stuff. And eventually a proverbial straw comes along, usually a very minor issue that breaks the camel's back. And the fabric of the family structure begins to unravel. And so I guess the question that we could ask now, maybe even process in your small groups, is this. Which of these five do you naturally default to? Because all of us have a tendency. And then the people living under your roof, which one of these do they default to? This message is not actually about conflict resolution. That is another seminar. What I want to talk about today is conflict minimization. How we can reduce the frequency and duration of those encounters, those difficult, conflict-filled encounters. And really, the way to minimize conflict is simply to wear certain attitudes all the time. And these attitudes I see in a story, one of my favorite stories in the whole Bible. It's the story of the prodigal son. And even though the son is the star of the story, I'm not so interested in focusing on the son as I am focusing on the father. This father in this story is like so great. And I know it's a parable. I know the dude doesn't even have a name. But if he did have a name, I wish his name was Tom Mercer. I actually do. Because he is just such a hero to me. And the way he deals with the conflict that he's presented with reflects these attitudes that he carries with him all the time. And they actually contribute not to the further damaging of the relationships in the family, but they contribute to his personal growth, the growth of all of the family members, and the way he approaches this conflict actually makes resolution of the conflict much more likely. So anyway, this guy's a great guy, and I want to show him to you today. Now, before we get to the passage, what I'd like to do is to show you the first attitude I see in his life, and we'll kind of sneak in the back door. But here we go, fill in some blanks. Number one, admit it. This is an attitude that you have to have as part of your conscious thought all the time. Understand, life is hard for everyone, not just you. You know, this goes back to that basic attitude that we have so often. And that is, I have it a lot tougher than you do, right? And we bring that into our conversations. I know life is hard for you. But hey, look at me, it's harder for me. You hear somebody in your relational world, maybe your spouse, maybe one of your kids say, hey, you know, something went bad today, went wrong today. And your response, instead of commiserating with them and weeping with those who weep, you say, oh, you think you had it tough. Why don't I tell you about my day? And we become embroiled in a difficult conversation, establishing or trying to establish why the person that you're speaking with, or the situation that you're in, has made things so hard for you. I read an article this past week, true story, testimony, about a wife who actually attempted suicide. Thankfully, she was not successful. And driving home in the car, all the husband could manage to say was this, I want you to know that you nearly scared me to death. And I'm thinking, is that all you got, bro? I mean, you can't even try to be sensitive to why she thought she wanted to kill herself? but it scared you. I mean, is that really the front burner issue in that car ride home? Instead of reaching out to her, you just scold her? Let me tell you something about life. It's hard for everybody. Sometimes we see others having it easy in areas that we find difficult. And if we could see underneath all the layers, we'd recognize that they find difficult what you find more easy. It's just a different hard. It's a different difficult. But it can be overwhelming for all of us. James Dobson said something a long time ago that got my attention as a husband. He said, a man derives his esteem primarily from his vocation. Now, he's taken some flack over the years for saying that, but the idea is not originating in his head. The idea actually goes all the way back to Genesis 3 when God was handing out these curses for the sin in the garden. And maybe you've read the greater context of Genesis 3, and God is cursing, you know, the enemy, Satan. He curses the snake. He curses the man. He curses the woman. And he's handing out all these curses. And the interesting thing is, it's not a blanket curse. But every curse is individualized for the particular recipient. For example, when it came to Adam and Eve, he didn't curse them the same way. He said to Adam, he said this in verse 17, Genesis 3, cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil, you'll eat food from it all the days of your life. As you try to provide for yourself and your family, it's almost as if the farm you're farming is going to be fighting back. Now, I know that most of you are not farmers. In fact, only 2 out of every 100 Americans actually are involved in farming farms. But we all have a farm. We all have jobs. We all have those vocations where we're trying to make a living and we're trying to get a return for our effort. Does it ever seem to you, farmers out there, that your farm is actually fighting you? And no matter how hard you work, how hard you try, you can't make ends meet. And the fact that you're gifted and you're capable is not the point. It seems like you might be one of the best in your class. But it's just so much harder than it ought to be. Can I hear a testimony? Absolutely. Now, some of you might even fill in that blank thinking, well, you're just living in the traditional world you grew up in, bro. I mean, this is a new world we live in now. You're thinking back to the old Ozzie and Harriet days. Well, actually, Ozzie didn't have a job at all, so that didn't work. But this is not just a traditional approach to family life. This is something that originates in the scripture, you guys. And then to the woman, what does God say? He says something totally different. Verse 16, I'm going to make your pains in childbearing very severe. With painful labor, you will give birth to children. And your desire will be for your husband, and he will rule over you. Now, that pain in childbirth is a no-brainer. Every mother in here gets that. And yet we tend to focus on that part of this curse for her sin. And we forget that last line, but it's that last line that is so powerful. In fact, the textual issues regarding the translation of that last line are really interesting. Your desire will be for your husband, he'll rule over you. What the word in the Hebrew refers to is a turning. And what God is saying is that the woman will primarily turn to her husband to help her to find her worth. But that's going to be difficult because now he's got his hands full at work since the farm is pushing back. And now what's going on under the roof of their home? There's a lot more ruling going on than relationship. And they both have a hard time finding rest for their souls, don't they? Because the world they live in is so unsettled. Now, this is not to say that men don't love or find great joy with their families. And it's neither to say that women should never enter the workforce. All I'm saying, the Bible says what it says, and hardwiring is very difficult to ignore here. You know, you could look at this almost as a chart. And since I'm the chart pastor, let me help you here. We need a pen that works, and I believe this one will. I am a man of great faith. There you go. Let's compare two things. A level of esteem. In other words, as we start here south and work our way north, we're feeling more confident, more affirmed. We're just feeling better. And then let's consider time. And right here, we're going to begin at the point of marriage. When is a woman's esteem at an all-time high? Well, if she finds her primary source of affirmation in her husband, it's on this particular day. I mean, she is riding a wave of affirmation. Dude showed up in a tuxedo. He'd been whining and dining her for, you know, ever. He stood up on a stage, and with that romantic look in his eye, he promised that he would be sensitive and caring and loving for the rest of his natural life. And then she gets these gift cards from Target and Bed Bath & Beyond and Macy's. And so what does she have? She has everything that she needs to set up her little nest. And, you know, all the right colors and the guest towels and the sheets. And, I mean, this is, you got candles. I mean, you got artwork. Is life good or what? And ladies are thinking, I am so, so, so happy right now. And then where is the guy on this particular day if he finds his primary source of affirmation in his vocation? It's probably, actually, the husband's is probably rather low. Why? Because dude doesn't even have a job yet. And if he has a job, it might not be in that career field that he has aspirations for. And even if he found his career identity, maybe he's in a corporation at the very bottom of the corporate ladder. And so he's working so hard to feel so good. And what happens over time? Generally speaking, he becomes more successful. And as that affirmation begins to come, he employs himself to a greater degree, throwing himself in his job. And over time, he feels better and better and better about himself. What happens to her? Well, we get a baby, comes along. And babies are a lot tougher than mom told me they would be. And then you have two, and then you have three. And since you're looking for esteem from this guy who happens to be pretty well focused on what he's doing vocationally, what happens to her esteem? It begins to plummet. And when does that point of crisis come? Well, counselors tell us it happens at about 10 to 15 years into the relationship. And about 20 years in, they end up calling a guy like me. And in the conversation, they say, Pastor, we don't know what happened, but our lives are now going what? Different directions. It happens all the time, unfortunately. But what does that have to do with this life is difficult for all of us conversation? Well, for a guy, it's hard to make a living. And I think it's important that women understand that. And I know that those gals, those of you gals who are in the workplace, you know that from a woman's point of view. But when that is your primary source of feeling good about who you are, that's a big deal. And in your conversations, I think, ladies, you need to factor that in. It's a biblical reality. And husbands need to recognize that for their wives, we can be a difficult place to find the esteem they need for their happiness and their fulfillment. I mean, we can be a problem, because we can be so hyper-focused on what makes us affirmed that we forget what is really fueling her in her life. And that's why so many women try to find their place in the workforce. They quit trying to find affirmation in their marriages because it's just not working out. Maybe they can find it someplace else. And if she's a stay-at-home mom with the responsibilities of children, it becomes a real problem. Guys tend to not come across very gently or humbly. But marriage is not the only difficult relationship in the family. In fact, when I go back to the story of the prodigal son and his dad, I read the first line in verse 11, and it says, a man had two sons. And you know what? I don't have to read anything else to know he had a very difficult life. I mean, I just know that. I mean, even if they were great sons, his life as a father was a tough life. I mean, I raised one son. Can't imagine two. I mean, I at some point, you know, as Drew got older, we had two alpha males living in the same pen. Can you imagine three? Some of you guys can imagine that because it's your context, it's your reality. Some of you have more than three. And then you mix in a father's love for his sons. And then you add to that how difficult it is for kids to grow up in any culture. And you've got a formula for stress. And it isn't just that there were two sons. It's that they were so different. As the story evolves, we see that their paradigm is totally different on so many things. Just when you think you got parenting figured out, what happens? God throws you a curveball. And you get a second kid who's so different from the first kid. And you're thinking, man, the things you learned with your first child are actually now working against you because your expectations are wrong. And then we start comparing one child to another. And oh man, that's never a good idea. Bottom line is that parenting is just plain hard. And kids don't understand that. That's the problem. We can't walk in someone else's shoes. A husband will never be a wife. A wife will never be a husband. You'll never be one another. A child will be a parent, but while they're living under your roof, they probably won't be. And as parents, we have short-term, long-term memory loss. We can't even remember what it was like being a kid. Kids need to recognize being a parent is hard. Parents need to recognize that being a kid is hard. Kids have it much tougher today than when we were growing up, you guys. I've actually heard parents tell their kids in my presence, oh, you think you got it tough when I was a kid? Fill in the blank. Dude, all I can tell you is that is the silliest thing I have like ever heard in my life. It has never been more difficult being a kid growing up in a culture in the history of humanity than it is today. Exponentially harder. And I guess the point is this. It's just hard for everybody living under your roof. They're all trying. We're all trying to overcome a ton of obstacles. Not just you. And if you think that you have it tougher than anybody else, you will become the primary obstacle everybody else has to deal with. So never start playing the woe is me more than you game. In fact, let's look back again at Philippians 2. We talked about this last week when we talked about the languages of love. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves. Don't look through the lens of your own interests, but each of you through the lens of the interests of others. In your relationships with one another, you guys just could not be more clear to us. Have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, which was what? I am gentle and I am humble. Humble enough to admit that you got a tough life. And I'm sorry about that. But that's why God sent me here. Because I'm going to help you. Second thing, anticipate it. Because failure leads to conflict. Why anticipate it? Because there's going to be a lot of failure in your world. You live in a failure-stricken environment. You could say that differences between us lead to conflict, and I would say you're wrong. It's not the differences between us that lead to conflict. Our failure to recognize that most of the time our not agreeing on something is okay. Our failure to recognize the diversity in the human family, the diversity in God's family, even the church. That's what accentuates failure. Conflict is always the result of failure. So it's always going to be part of our context. And if you don't expect conflict, you're naive. It's coming. You're going to have conflict. Never underestimate the power of expectations. Don't be surprised when failure shows up in your family and conflict shows up in your conversation. You know, Pastor Tom, we have conflict. Okay, what's your point? And our enemy tries to leverage every opportunity he can to knock us off our pins so that that conflict destroys us rather than brings us together, because it can bring us together. Conflict, conflict, conflict. In every parent-child relationship, there's an inherent power struggle from day one. I mean, when it comes to marriage, at least you got a honeymoon. You bring a baby home, there's no honeymoon. It's like game on, day one, game on. Waking up at 2 o'clock in the morning and screaming something. I'm not sure what they're screaming, but it sounds an awful lot like, what are you guys, lazy? Don't you know I haven't eaten in hours? And you call yourself a mother. And I wish I could tell you it gets easier. It doesn't get easier. A lot of families have problems because the CEOs don't occupy the corner office. And what happens is, you know, a couple gets married and they have a couple of kids, and the moment those kids come home from the hospital, the newest member of the firm, that pint-sized sinner, looks over the company spreadsheets and says, I'll be taking over from here. Mom and Dad, you're no longer in the corner office. I'm sitting in the CEO's chair. I want the keys to the corporate jet. I'm going to have all the stock options. Everybody's going to support me. You can still stay employed, but you're no longer in charge. Now you're my support team. And amazingly, you know what parents say? Okay. We'll move out of the office. We'll take a pay cut, and you can be in charge. And then a lot of resignations take place, and the wife resigns her position as being a wife. And she becomes a mom. She marries the kids. And the husband resigns from being the husband, and he marries his career. And nobody knows who's married to whom. Nobody knows who's leading the charge. For a husband to have a relationship with his wife, he has to negotiate all the kids' extracurricular activities. For the wife to have a relationship with her husband, she has to negotiate all the requirements of his vocation. She has to call a secretary for an appointment. Now you got high stress, high conflict, and low romance. Family stock takes a dive. You know, when the child is born, the parent's supposed to be in control. Now, over time, as a child grows into adulthood, that control gradually needs to shift to the kid. And that's the way it should be. We all want to raise children who are independent thinkers. We all want to raise children who are competent adults. But we got a problem, actually a couple of problems. Number one, our kids want control quicker than we as parents should give it to them. And number two, we as parents become so overwhelmed and fatigued by the conflict, we actually give them more control simply to reduce the level of angst in the relationship. And the result is that the conflict is just punted downfield, and it comes back later much greater than it presently is. If we were only willing to confront the issues at the appropriate time. You can pay me now, or you can pay me later. But baby, I'll tell you something, you're going to be paying the piper for a lack of attentiveness to this issue. We don't even know how old this young man in the parable was. He was probably a teenager. And what did he say? He said what teenagers always say. Oh man, if I could only have my own place, if I could only call the shots, if I could only choose my own friends, date anybody I want, stay out as late as I want. I mean, what teenager in any generation, in any culture, has not said that? Now, if you're a teenager here today, I want to talk to you for a minute. It's you and me. And if you're not a teenager, just take a break. This is not for you. But kids, I have never lied to you before, and I will not lie to you now. I've got an advantage in this conversation with you, because I'm a parent, and you're a child, and you, as of yet, don't know what it's like to be a parent. I know what it's like to be both, so I have a little bit of an advantage. I have another advantage because I know the Bible better than you do. And then I have another advantage today, because I'm not your father, so I'm not feeling badly about some difficult conversation we've had recently. I can be completely objective. In fact, I have a fourth advantage. I have the microphone, and you don't. And all I'm saying is the truth. You're probably not ready to take over the company firm yet. You're not. At some point you will be. And you won't even have to tell your parents when that day comes, because they'll know it. They might not want to accept it, because that's a hard moment for us as parents. I can remember that happening 3 times in my life. None of them were easy. But I was never naive to it. But you can't say it's my life. It's my business. I can do what I want to do. If my family would just stay out of my life, it would be great. Because it's my life, right? Your mom and dad said that when they were kids, too. But it's no more true for you than it was for them that many years ago. Let's say that you were like stranded in the Pacific Ocean in a boat with your family. And you don't even know when you're going to be rescued. And all of a sudden, you pull out a knife and you start drilling a hole in the hull of the boat underneath your seat. And your family says, what are you doing? You're going to sink the boat. What are you going to say? Hey, it's my knife. This is my seat. This is my hole. No, bro, you just have to cool your jets, because everybody's going down here if you're not careful. See, even though you think that you're ready, you might not be yet. And parents, I want you to know that our decisions about the decisions our children make are very important. Sometimes wisdom forces us to suck it up and let them make the mistakes without rescuing them. We'll have much more to say about that next weekend. But you cannot raise kids in an environment that dismisses the law of the harvest, because the law of the harvest eventually catches up with everybody. You will reap what you sow. And sometimes we have to let our children reap what they sow in order to learn that law. Look at what this kid says. Younger kid comes to the dad, says, Dad, give me my share of the estate. So he divides his property between them. And not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. At first, everything goes great. He's having a blast. Does everything his father never allowed him to do. He throws out his parents' value system, completely rejects his upbringing, wastes everything that he has. And that's the thing about rebellion, it is always such a waste. You know. Because at some point you always have to come back. And when you come back, you have less money to spend. You have less time to find the happiness you're looking for. You have less physical health to enjoy it. And you have less respect from the people that you care about. Rebellion is a waste. But getting back to the dad, what do you think he was thinking when he heard what his son was going to do? What do you think the dad was thinking? Do you think he knew that his son would waste that money? Do you think he was wise enough to recognize that he was going to squander the money and waste that particular season of his life? Do you think the father knew he was going to get in trouble? Oh, absolutely. Do you think he was tempted to dispatch some of his servants to go find the kid and bring him back? Yep, because he would think just like I would think and you would think. But this dad was smarter than that. And he realized there are some things we only learn through the school of hard knocks. And even though it was a risk, he knew that sometimes it's the only way to learn a valuable lesson. And so as the story continues, after that kid had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. And so he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. See, there's the price tag for rebellion. Kid hit bottom. He was broke, he was friendless, he was hungry, and he was embarrassed. And the parents, you know what they were feeling. The story doesn't even mention the mom here. But mothers, would you like to weigh in? No one enjoys watching people they love hurt themselves, make poor choices, turn away from everything they've been taught. I can imagine they were embarrassed answering the same old questions from different people would say, oh, how's little Johnny doing? You know, if you're a kosher Jew, it doesn't get any lower than feeding the pigs. And I'm sure they felt self-condemnation. I'm sure they laid awake at night beating themselves up. The old, where did we go wrong thing, right? Well, for those of you who may be feeling this a little uncomfortably right now, I would like to try to encourage you for a moment. We all make mistakes as parents. There's no doubt about that. None of us are perfect. But we are not the only influence in our children's lives. They have friends we don't control. They have time we don't control. They have teachers we don't control. They have mentors we might not even know about. Certainly, we have to be vigilant, and if there's some culpability involved for us, we have to be willing to take the shots. But it's not fair to take all of the blame ourselves. See, it may not be your fault at all. Our kids make decisions just like you made decisions. And the things that you got into weren't all your parents' fault, were they? You know, I was thinking about that, and I reflected on the reality that the only perfect parent I've ever met is God the Father. And He's got a whole lot of rebellious children. But this kid broke. Actually, he broke long before he was broken. But being broken is a prerequisite to restoration. And so here, let me just share with you number three. Expect it. Expect it. Because grace will win. Grace always wins. It's the story of mankind. It's the story of the Bible. It's the story of the prodigal son. And it's your story. You just haven't lived it all yet. But you will. God's grace is sufficient for you. Kid gets up and he goes to his father, and while he was still a long way away, his dad saw him, was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him and kissed him. While the kid was still a long way away, the father went to meet him. Now, how is that possible unless the dad was watching? Watching for any sign of his son's return. See, this dad is such a great dad, he knew that it was only a matter of time before grace wins. He wouldn't read the paper when the kid knocked at the door. Oh, it's you. You back? In fact, if the father hadn't been watching, the son may not have made it all the way up the driveway. I can only imagine what's going through that kid's mind as he's on his way home and he turns the corner and he sees his home. And what's the devil telling him? You can't go back there. Do you realize the condemnation that you're going to experience if you try to go home? Can you imagine that finger pointed in your face telling you that you were such a loser? You know, if the dad hadn't run down the driveway to get him, that reunion would have never taken place. But that father was not going to give his son the chance to have that conversation with the enemy. And that's why we all have to watch for signs of repentance. Because those signs of repentance encourage conflict to be resolved. And the son says to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Father said, forget that, boy. Quick, bring the best robe. Put it on him. Put a ring on his finger. Sandals on his feet. Bring the fatted calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to celebrate. You know, someone once told me that God never rubs it in. He rubs it out. And this father did not say, I told you so. Next time you'll listen to me. When that kid came home, the last thing he needed was a sermon. He had already heard the sermon. And the text was the law of the harvest. And the preacher was God. You know, this story would be great if it just ended there. It doesn't end there, which is why we get to number four. Brace for it. More conflict on its way. You know, just when we're ready to, you know, wrap this thing up with a nice ribbon and say conflict resolved, the older brother shows up. And he becomes angry and refused to go in. And his father goes out and pleads with him. But he answered his dad, look, all these years, I've been slaving for you, never disobeyed your orders, yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could have a party with my friends. When this son of yours, notice, not my brother, when this son of yours who has squandered your property with prostitutes comes home, you kill the fatted calf for him. And all I'm thinking is, oh boy, here we go again. Now we get to deal with a good brother. But you know what? When I read that, it doesn't surprise me at all. You know why? Because for that brother, life was hard for him too. And failure, it happens to all of us. And it always leads to conflict. But in that situation, grace is bound to still come out on top. And then, they'll get to move on to the next one. Will this ever end? Yeah. The day you croak, it'll end. You know, heaven is a wonderful place, filled with God's glory and grace. But folks, this ain't heaven. This is Victorville. And we got us some work to do. You know what I'm saying? So let's carry these attitudes with us this week. Let's bow for prayer. Father, thank you for giving us an opportunity to just spend some time reflecting on ourselves and, you know, our lack of Christ-likeness. Actually contributing to the conflict in our families. Let us be rebuked today, Father, by the example of your Son, who was gentle and humble. Let us be like him, even this week. Guide our conversations, and let us just recognize how important it is to be one step ahead of the enemy and to see his schemes, his ploys, and to be prepared in our spirit for whatever comes our way this week. With everybody's head bowed and your eyes closed, I would just tell you, as we do each time, that there is absolutely no way you can live the kind of life we've described today in your own strength. This is a superhuman kind of lifestyle. You can't do it, I can't do it, but Jesus can, and Jesus did. And if you invite him into your life, he will live his life through you. ABC, admit that you need his help. You're a sinner and you need a Savior. B, believe that only Jesus can help you. He really is the only one who can. And then C, choose. Place your faith in Christ. Make a choice today. Right now, Lord, I admit that I need you. I believe that you can help me. I choose to place my faith in Jesus, not just for my eternity, but because I'm going to need that. Even when I leave this auditorium, when I wake up in the morning, I'm going to need Jesus living through me to accomplish your purpose in my life. Father, I thank you for any work you do here. We worship you for that. And we give you all of the glory and all of the credit in Jesus' name. All God's children said, amen. Welcome forms in the baskets. Men's barbecue tickets outside. And we'll see you next week. Talk about discipline.